Hello, my fellow YouTubers and subscribers, and welcome to my latest movie review, where today I review the 2020 live-action adaptation of The Secret Garden. Amidst the COVID-19 pandemic, this movie was scheduled to be released, I think, in Easter, like back in April this year, but of course, due to the COVID pandemic, it was delayed. And they've decided to shove it in certain cinemas for half term. Not that it will make a profit as such, but it'll at least be something for the children to go and see, while certain cinemas are still open anyway. But anyway, I thought because I am a big fan of the 1993 movie, I thought I'd come and see this version. I am going to be reviewing the 1993 Secret Garden film with another subscriber. I'm doing it as a collaborative movie review with Sci First Movie Talk. We weren't sort of sure what time-wise when we were going to do it, because we just thought this movie was delayed, but I only recently found out that my local cinema was showing this version of The Secret Garden, so I thought I'll review this version first, and then I'll go back and review the 1993 version. Anyway, the story of The Secret Garden is that it's based on a novel written by Frances Hodgson Burnett, and it tells the story of a young girl named Mary Lennox. Her parents die rather tragically. She lives in India, but then she is sent to her uncle's manor, which is called Misselthwaite Manor. And there she meets her seemingly ill cousin, Colin, and together they discover some truths about their heritage and about their mothers, who are actually twin sisters. And then Mary has to try and fix the dysfunctions within her family through the discovery of the secret garden, which her aunt previously owned. And it kind of goes on from there. It's a real emotional drama. They also meet a boy named Dickon, who's very good with animals, and his sister is also a maid in the household. And there's this evil housekeeper called Mrs. Medlock, who's very strict, who is trying to keep Mary locked in her room all the time. And yeah, that's basically it. So the 2020 version of The Secret Garden, that's all I have to say. Meh. Yeah, I was really disappointed with this film. First of all, because it was produced by David Heyman, who is a fabulous producer. I mean, he's produced such classics as Harry Potter. He was a producer on the Harry Potter films, as well as the Paddington movies as well. So this guy can produce. He's a very talented guy, but this film is very disjointed. They've completely lost the whole message of The Secret Garden story. Now, I myself haven't actually read the novel, but I know what it's about, obviously, and I've seen the 1993 film, and to me, this movie completely messes with the story. It tries to reorder things, tries to restructure things, it tries to put its too much of its own artistic license on it, that they basically have lost all concept of the story, to the point where you just kind of watch it thinking, what am I supposed to be feeling here? I'm not feeling any emotion from this. And for me, that's the biggest problem with this new Secret Garden movie, is that you don't feel anything. Its heart is in the right place, don't get me wrong, but I just feel like the actors can't work with anything because the script is very disjointed. The emotional storyline doesn't work as well as the 1993 movie, for me. Also, I think the actors aren't that good, to be honest. I mean, the actress that plays Mary, Dixie Egerix, she's pretty bland, to be honest. I mean, to begin with, she's just a bore. Like, she's just absolutely boring. Mary doesn't really change as a character very much in this version. In the 1993 version, we see a complete change to Mary's character, which I will go into when I review it myself. As for this version, Mary is just bored. She looks completely, you know, bored and depressed, and the first act is very padded out. It takes such a long time for her to actually get to Misselthwaite, and then for her to actually get to discovering the secret garden. So the first act is very drawn out, and I think they could have lost about 15 minutes of this film. It's 105 minutes, but it could honestly lose 15 minutes of its runtime. It should have been dead on 90 minutes. In the first act, we just get this long, extensive prologue about her parents and her basically being lonely. Like, Mary has no friends. She talks to her little toy that she calls Jemima, and she's constantly telling stories, and it's just like, when are we going to actually start the film? I mean, come on, let's just get going here. When I saw this movie just now in the cinema with my friend Nicholas Payne, shout out, by the way, I was very surprised to hear some of the kids in the screen were actually very bored. And a lot of them were talking throughout the middle of the film, which was really distracting. But in a way, I can't blame them, because what was on that screen was not very interesting. I just found Dixie Eggerichs to be very, very bland and very boring. She didn't compel me. She's a cute little girl, and she's not bad. She's not awful, but I think she's just completely bland. There's no characterization there. I mean, I struggle to see why they cast her, to be honest. You've got Amir Wilson as Dickon. He's also pretty boring as well. He doesn't really get to do that much in the film. He's more heavily involved in the 1993 version. He's got much more personality there. This guy just brings no personality to it. And to be fair, the script they have to work with is not very good at all. Edan Hayhurst as Colin. He's probably the best of the child actors, but that's not saying an awful lot. I just felt like they didn't really give much time for him, to be honest. Like, in the original version, there's this whole, you know, long section where we're seeing that he's not sick when he's pretending to be sick. And then there's this whole arc of him actually, you know, realizing that he isn't unwell, and he can walk and he can do all these physical things. But the film totally loses focus. This version, there is no focus. It seems to be struggling to maintain focus on Mary. Then it seems to be struggling to maintain focus on the emotional story. And it ends up being pretty much a convoluted mess, which is a real shame. I wouldn't say this movie is terrible. I would say it's okay, it's fine, it's pretty, like, it looks really pretty. The cinematography is great, and there are a lot of slow motion shots of the garden, and it does look beautiful, but it ain't a patch on the 1993 version. Honestly, I think the 1993 film is far superior than this. Again, like I said, the first act is just too long, and it really does drag in the beginning, and not only until she actually found the garden was I like, okay, finally, we're actually here, we're actually interested. And in the 1993 film, sorry to keep comparing it to that, but in that version, they made a big deal about the garden and revealing the garden to be this magical, wondrous place. In this version, it's like any old garden. They don't make enough of this garden. We are told how amazing and wonderful it is, but we don't actually really get to see that, if you know what I mean. It's shown to us, but we don't see it. It's almost like someone's trying to sell you a false holiday. They big it up to say, oh wow, look at how amazing this is. This will change your life. It's revolutionary. And then when you get there, you find it's actually a bit crap. Not to say that the garden they're in is a bit crap, but it feels more like a field than a garden. It feels more like a field and a forest with loads of flowers than it does a garden. From a conceptual point of view, they probably could have done a bit more to explain that, but there is a gate with a key that opens a door, so it is clearly meant to be a garden. But geographically speaking, it's just something I find a bit strange. Julie Walters is Mrs. Medlock in this film, and she gives a good performance, but she's wasted. Mrs. Medlock is supposed to be quite mean and nasty, and she is in the original version, and in this version she doesn't go on any character journey whatsoever. She's the same as she is at the beginning and at the end. Whereas in the 93 version, she's a nasty, mean witch, and then she mellows out by the end and she realizes what she's done and how she's, you know, tried to stop Mary from seeing her family. It's a shame that Julie Walters did not get to really explore the character very much. She puts on a decent performance, but it's meaningless because she doesn't get anything to do, and that's a real shame. I think also Colin Firth as Craven, the uncle, Mary's uncle and Colin's father. Colin Firth is good in the role. He's probably the best performance of the film, just simply because of what his character is going through. I do think in this version, it's obviously a little bit different because he doesn't leave as much, whereas in the original version, Craven leaves quite a lot, and we don't really see him that much. He's a bit of an enigma, but in this version, we're seeing Craven, basically he's drinking and he accidentally causes a fire, and he's just a broken man. We see much more of how broken he is. We do see that in the original version, but in a different context. So I thought Colin Firth did a great job of selling the grief of the widowed husband and the father who wasn't really connecting with his son, which is a real shame. And the moment when Colin and Craven finally meet at the end is nice, and it is emotionally satisfying, but not as much as you would hope, because you haven't had the build-up. The film hasn't flowed through enough for you to feel impacted by that. Also, the music of the film is good. I think it's a decent soundtrack, but it's nothing amazing. It's quite repetitive and monotonous, to be honest, but that's all there is to it. Like I said, it has its emotional scenes, and the film has its heart in the right place, but it's very disjointed. It doesn't fit together. because there's another moment where Mary talks about her father because they discover that the dog that they find is actually a male dog. She thought it was female. Anyway, they're renaming the dog, and she says, "My dad's name was Marcus, but don't name the dog after him, please." So that gives us the complete indication that she wasn't really close to her dad, and she didn't really like her dad. Later on, it's very polarizing because we discover there's a flashback scene where Mary's talking to her dad, and Mary discovers the reason why her mum is basically neglecting her. And he kind of explains it. The way she interacts with her dad, it doesn't give the impression that she doesn't like him. So I think the film gets very confused with the story. Narratively, it is a bit of a mess, to be honest. It's emotionally, it doesn't work structurally. It feels like they rushed the script. The script is the biggest issue with this film because the whole message of the story is completely lost. And you just sit there thinking, well, I'm just watching people in a garden. There's nothing else to it. It's quite a boring film to sit through, to be honest. The third act is a bit better. It does get a bit more exciting. For some reason, there's a fire scene. I'm not sure quite why they needed to have the mansion burn on fire, but okay, fair enough. I don't know how close that is to the book, but whatever. I just found that scene to be kind of pointless. It was just thrown in there just for the sake of having a climax, and then the end of the film seeing Mary trying to let go of her mother, which is really strange. I know that she does realize at the end that her mother wasn't all bad, and she had her reasons for neglecting Mary, but still, it gave us the wrong impression because Mary hates her mother. You know, in the story, Mary hates her mum. Then at the very end, it seems like the film just contradicted itself by having Mary say, "Oh, don't go. I know you can't stay, but please don't go." It's just like, what? Like, I'm confused. What am I supposed to think here? Like, it's honestly, it's a mess. It's a real shame that this story is so incomprehensibly told. It really is. But that being said, it's not a bad film. I don't think it's terrible. I think it's pleasant enough for children that who you know will probably enjoy this sort of thing. Although they may get bored in certain sections of it because it does drag, I think, quite a bit. It has its heart in the right place, but it doesn't. The emotional beats do not land very well for me. The acting is kind of poor for the child actors. I just think that Mary should have evolved much more than she does in this version. In this version, Dixie Egerex is very bland. The direction by Mark Munden is very poor. I must say, he's very poor. He hasn't managed to stitch this together quite well. I'm sorry. It really is a shame because I do love the story of The Secret Garden. And it is a lovely, beautiful story. But this version is just boring. It's just completely boring. It's dull. It's lifeless. It basically is insignificant. But it looks nice. Some decent performances. And that's kind of it, really. It's charming, but it's not as charming as its predecessor, shall we say. So with that in mind, I think I'll have to give The Secret Garden 2020 5 out of 10. Anthem, hear the flowers like their hymn has healing power. Take my hand and breathe in the colourful. Won't you let... I can't give it any more than that. Like, it's okay, but yeah, it's a real disappointment. On a final note, I want to give another quick shout out to Nicholas Payne. We went and saw the movie together, so please check out his review when he uploads that. And please stay tuned for my review, my collaborative review, of the 1993 Secret Garden movie, which is vastly better than this. So anyway, thank you all very much for watching, and until next time, I'm Mr. TARDIS 11. See you soon. Bye for now.